Morning. Hope you're all doing well this morning. It is good to be together. I am Pastor Daniel, pastor here at the McCordsville United Methodist Church. And that was an interesting sound. Something going on somewhere, but that's all right. Anyhow, it is good to be together. And our hope and our prayer today through this time of worship is that we will all encounter the resurrected Christ. And through that encounter, that our God would do a work of grace within our hearts, within our minds, within our lives. Amen. Amen. Well, I do have some important tidbits to share with you. Some important tidbits. The youth group will be meeting this Tuesday at 6:30 p.m. And my important tidbits just went poof. Poof. There they come back. Wednesday, our food pantry will be open from 9 to 10 o'clock. If you know of anyone that is in need of any food, we are stocked. So please, please reach out to us. That way we can partner together and make sure whomever it is that you know is in need of food is fully stocked. So please, please, the church, you all, and the community have been extraordinarily generous with our food pantry. So again, let us, you know, work together and feed folks within our community. Amen? Amen. Also, a couple important announcements here. The United Methodist Men will not be meeting on July the 5th. They will not be meeting on July the 5th. And the UMW is going to be postponing their normal meeting to July the 13th at noon. And with that, it happens to be birthday Sunday. And I think we may even have a slide. There it is. For the month of June. Let's stand for today's call to worship. Majesty.
Let's sing it out. Here we go.
Majesty. Worship His majesty.
Spirit have led us to be gathered here in this place to worship you. Father, we pray that during this time of worship that you would place us all upon your potter's wheel, and that God, that you would do a work of grace within us all. Father, this day we truly surrender our entire lives to your Son, and this day we say, have your way in us. And all God's people said, amen.
Let's continue singing by singing a hymn, Blessed Assurance.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is
Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
This morning, in the midst of the important tidbits that I shared, I did admit something that is both a bit of an announcement, but also even a prayer concern, and just bathing the upcoming Lord's Acre Festival in prayer. You will find, I believe these are at the round table down as you're exiting in the building, a newsletter that explains all the important information about Lord's Acre Festival that you've heard us talking about. So if you would, on your way out of the church, please grab one of these. And then there is also a sign-up sheet thing to get us an idea of the number of volunteers and the folks that we'll have to be able to put on this year's Lord's Acre. There are also a few of them in the back if you were to exit out these doors here as well. But again, we're inviting you to join us in prayer and intercession for this year's Lord's Acre, and just pray that God would bless our efforts and that time together would be a time where the community is able to gather together in love and for us to love on them. Amen? Amen. Do we have any joys, though, that we would like to share with one another? Any joys today that we would like to share? And here it is. Yes. Isn't it though? It is sitting. Yeah. Majesty is just like, yes, it was a powerful thing today. Yes, yes. And I want to echo what Regina shared. Just seeing everyone in the pews is just a joy. And then seeing the smiles etched on folks' faces and the singing. Yes, yes. As Tim had already said earlier as well. Any others? Yeah, Joe. Definitely, definitely. Joe just asked for prayers for the Voorhees family. They're twins. It sounds born prematurely, very tiny. So, and we know, as with our prayers with baby Finn, that God definitely has a heart for these littles. So definitely join in prayer for them and the family and the parents and for those two twins. Absolutely, absolutely. Any other joys? Yeah. Yes, yes. I'm glad you mentioned Lee too. And it is good to have you back, Jim. Last week I look over for our word and you were gone. Yes. Oh, but yes, and then Jim also mentioned our good friend Lee Guthrie. He's been a part of this church for I don't know how many decades, but it's been, yeah, Sharon's mouthing back there forever. So he has been here forever. But anyhow, But Lee, this last week, he went in to have a checkup, and that led to an ER visit, which led to him eventually having a pacemaker put in. He is home, and I talked with him, and he said he feels 200% better and can't believe how good he feels. So he is doing much better than he was previously. So that is great news about Lee, definitely, definitely. Also do have another praise. Another good friend of our church, Bob Hart, has been attending the second service. I know he's also been in this church for a good long while, and it is just amazing to see Bob and to continue to worship with him. If you linger around till about 11, you'll get to see him in person, but it has been good to see Bob. Yes, Karen? Yes, Karen Lee just shared just a heartfelt thanks about our church's hospitality with having her husband's celebration of life, and what a life he lived. And that was very apparent with the words from your kids, and and a great time. It was a great time celebrating him. And one of my favorite bits of it, Bob was a Michigan State fan, and so I had to have a little fun with Don Bowen, who is definitely not a Michigan State guy. Yeah, he might be an Ohio State guy. Yes, and he might have even said, "Hey, Daniel, you know what would be a good idea?" And I said, "What's that?" I'm gonna go on the other side of the room and I'm gonna say OH, and then you over here say IO. I didn't do it. Nope. But it was a great time, and I think Bob would appreciate the humor. He was someone that loved to laugh, and was just an incredible, incredible guy. So, Tim. Yes, and echoing what Tim shared about the vendor applications are there. 85 applications were sent out to folks that we've been connected with in the past. And then we as a church made the decision to not charge them this year as a statement of just a thank you for coming back out, and also just to help them out a little bit, as the pandemic has done things. Yes, so I think that was a great move, and another very hospitable move on our church's behalf, definitely. Any other praises? Yes. Yes, Lily and Annabelle, prayers that they don't fight on that airplane and make it home safely from Bob and Kathleen's. Definitely, definitely. Any other prayer concerns? Any prayer concerns? Yeah. Oh, yeah. Absolutely. And Amy shared, yeah. Yes, yes. Amy Reeves shared about today's bowling outing at 2 o'clock. And again, it's just good for us to begin to see these bit of normalcy coming back into all of our lives. And I want to echo something. Yesterday afternoon, I got the opportunity to go over to Amy and Greg Burse's for a birthday party for Riker. And I don't know, at one point I was just kind of sitting on this this porch, and I was watching these kids be kids. And it was just felt so good to see children being children and laughing and spraying each other with water and throwing each other down. The funniest thing we saw, though, and then we'll have to move on, is there was this one little boy had a Spider-Man mask and a Captain America shield, and he goes into this little bounce thing. He gets knocked over, and he jumps up, and he grabs a shield, and he flings it at the person that hit it and knocks him down. I was like, it's good to see some normalcy. But I was like, that's the next Aaron Rodgers. Or not Aaron Rodgers. What's his name? I know. What is it, Corey? Steve Rodgers. Thank you. Thank you. Okay. I know. I'm thinking football. You know, I've mixed up football, and I'm sorry. Well, isn't this good? It's good to talk. It's good to laugh. It's good to be together. And now let's pray together. Lord Jesus, we're just thankful that you are the author of life, and that the joy that you share is a joy that goes beyond circumstances, goes beyond situations within life, within society, and it's a joy that we can have within our lives that just is a constant stream within us. Lord, this morning we pray for those people that have been mentioned that are recovering from surgeries. We pray for those families that are in a time of grieving and the passing of loved ones. Father, we just thank you that that society is beginning to become a little bit more normal by the day. And we just pray, God, for protection, health, and healing over the lives of the people in our lives, our neighbors, our friends, our coworkers, those across this country and those across this world. Father, this day we also take a moment and we pray for all those families affected and impacted by the collapse of that condo in Florida. And Father, we pray for the families that are waiting the news to find out how their loved one is. And we just pray that right now, God, that your hands and feet, your children, would go and be with those families, that they would just wait with those families, cry with those families, and be with those families. Father, we pray for your healing to right now just begin to be poured into their lives and as they're trying to piece together what happened. And Lord, this day we also pray for those people within our communities, within our neighborhoods, that are outside of a relationship with you and a relationship with your church. Father, we pray that we would be the magnet, that we would be the light, that we would be the catalyst that would bring them through these doors and be a part of this church. Father, we pray that you would give us a grace-filled boldness just to invite and just to share that invitation that someone had shared with us to be here today. Father, we pray for these neighbors, and we just pray that right now, God, you would pour your grace, pour your life, pour your love deep within. And now, Lord, we pray the prayer that you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Powerful statement there, Tim. Powerful statement, and well done. Yes, indeed. The wonder of it all. Oh, today we are going to be continuing this journey through the letter of Ephesians, and we'll continue this snail pace as we are now just going to enter into the 15th verse after four messages, but a lot of material, a lot of things to look at, but we will be continuing down this path. And the title of this message here today is One More Bale. But have you ever just felt like you couldn't take that next step? That you had exhausted all of the inner resources that you contained, and that next step, you just didn't feel like it was possible. Maybe you'd gotten into the adventure, taken on the feat with some sort of surge of excitement, hoping beyond hope that you would be able to accomplish the said task with a little trouble, if none at all. Maybe you approached it just knowing it'd be an easy task, something that wouldn't be a problem at all to accomplish. But then as the journey unfolded, then as the task waned on ahead, that dreaded fatigue hit. And you just didn't know if you could carry on. Anyone ever felt like that before? Worn? At times, life, like we said last week, can be a struggle. But at times, life can also be rather taxing. And in the midst of living through it, a bit draining. The Apostle Paul, that we've been discussing quite a bit here lately, he understood this all so well. At one point, he referred to the living of his life as being poured out like a drink offering. Philippians 2:17. Even if I am being poured out like a drink offering, he says, on the sacrifice and service coming from your faith, he says, I am glad and I rejoice with all of you. One of the types of sacrifices in the Old Testament was just that, a drink offering. The first of these occurred when Jacob wrestled with the Lord just before he received the name Israel. After the struggle, as a sign of a covenant unto God, he poured out a drink offering. Interesting bit of a story behind the story here. Paul, having also struggled through ministry, struggled through life's toils, felt as if he, while sitting in that jail cell writing this letter, felt that he had been poured out like a drink offering. But in the midst of life, we can all feel a bit like that. Poured out, drained dry, unsure if we would be able to stay the course, to the words of Bob Dylan, to keep on keeping on. Story. You know, growing and still to this day, my dad was someone that loved all things horse. He loved riding them, training them, breaking them, taking care of them, all thing horse. That was and still to this day is my dad. Well, if you know anything about horses, they like to eat. Grain, corn, grass, yes, but they also like to eat hay. And something that I've, since a young teen, wished were a thing was that hay would just miraculously spring up on its own in a bale where it's supposed to be in a barn's hayloft. But just as money does not grow on trees, nor do barns replenish hay bales automatically. The only way that hay can make its way into a barn's hayloft is if someone puts it there. Well, my dad, he had a couple of those someones. One named Andrew and one named Daniel. Baling hay has got to be one of the hardest, hottest jobs possible. Hay never seems to be ready when it's 65 and breezy. No. No, it's always ready when it's 105 and humid. Well, that's how I remembered it when I was younger anyways. But every summer, I knew it was coming. And I knew it would be on the hottest day of the summer possible. I knew that Dad would wake Andy and I. And with a big old smile on his face, he would tell us the worst sort of news possible. It's baling hay day. Well, this one time I remember baling hay with Dad, I got the feeling rough. My arms felt like jello. I was hot. Nose was plugged up. I was hacking up a storm. And every single bale of hay that I tossed onto that trailer bed, I thought it was going to be my last. Now, my dad promised pay. He did promise pay for baling hay. So that was something I could keep in the forefront of my mind. I'm going to get paid. But every bay of hell that I picked up, and kicked up with my knee, if you know the true proper way to do so, and tossed on that trailer bed, it seemed to diminish the importance of that pay. Finally, at one point, I called out to Dad. I said, Dad, I think I'm dying here. I don't know if I can keep on tossing this hay. To which my dad said, Daniel, before you die, please throw one more bale. Needless to say, I didn't die. And I did throw at least one more bale. But sometimes life can feel an awful lot like baling hay. Being able to toss one more bale, take one more step, clock in one more time. At times it man, just from the weight of life, it just doesn't seem possible. But just like my dad encouraged me to throw one more bale, so does our God encourage us to keep on keeping on, to stay the course that we have committed our lives to not allow the frustrations of life to bog us down to the point of despair. For God has promised us something, that he will be with us, that he, Hebrews chapter 13, will never in any circumstance forsake us, but rather that he will be with us and give us that which we need the most just when we actually need it. That is, he is the God that enables us through this life to keep on keeping on, no matter what. Which brings us to our passage this morning, Ephesians chapter 1, verses 15 through 21. I invite you to stand with me for this portion of the reading of God's word. Paul, writing here, says, I keep asking that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation. And I love this part. You didn't write that. That was me. So that you may know him better. It says, I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which he has called you, that you may know the riches of his glorious inheritance and his holy people, and that you may know his incomparably great power for us who believe. Paul writes, that power is the same as the mighty strength he exerted when he raised Christ Jesus from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly realms. Paul says, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion and every name that is invoked, not only in the present age, but also in the one to come. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, we pray that these words would come true within our hearts and within our minds. And we pray and we know that the only way that's possible is that if you, the Holy Spirit, would take these words and do your work within us by them. And all God's people said, amen. You may be seated. You know, we often in thinking about the scriptures, and it's probably due to the sacred nature and our sacred view of them, we often think that they were written by people that were somehow, some way unlike us. That as they were living life, that these writers of scripture, that they lived life unscathed. That they somehow were impervious to the toils and snares and challenges of life. But the more that I study scriptures, the more I give my mind and my heart to them, the more that I realize that that just is not the case. Rather, it was through life. Real life, with all of its challenges, with God, that the scriptures came to be. N.T. Wright, in his book, Paul, a Biography, he makes the case, he makes the argument, that there was a point in even the Apostle Paul's life where he almost broke, where he almost gave up, where he almost threw in the towel. That is Paul. Even beyond feeling as if he had been poured out like a drink offering, that he almost buckled under the weight and the pressures of life and ministry. It was a bit of a culmination of things that caused this almost breaking point, N.T. Wright writes. You've heard about two of them already. The riot that occurred in Ephesus, and his time of imprisonment that I just recently learned was also in Ephesus. But what was it? What was the straw that almost broke the camel's back for old Paul? Well, as these things usually come about, it was during a high point, during a mountaintop experience, that a curveball unexpectedly got chucked his way that caused him to plummet rather rapidly off of his mountain perch. Ministry had taken off in Ephesus like wildfire. As we learned, it went so well that the entire landscape of Ephesus was changing. The cultural and custom norms in the city were being turned on its head. People in droves were coming to hear this apostle tell his story about the Messiah, the one true Lord, the Lord over the whole earth, over even Caesar, who had conquered even death. Paul saw no need to dress up this gospel, to add anything fancy or flashy to it. He just told and retold the story as God had told it himself. As N.T. Wright likes to say, told the story of Genesis, Exodus, David, Messiah, exile, and then Jesus. And people's lives were being turned upside down and hearing it. The business surrounding Artemis and the riot wasn't the only indicator of this change. Because of the ministry of Paul, the Acts chapter 19, verse 17, the name of the Lord Jesus was held in high honor. Many of those who believed now came and openly confessed what they had done. A number who had practiced sorcery brought their scrolls together and burned them publicly. When they calculated the value of the scrolls, it came to a total of 50,000 drachmas. In this way, and I love this statement, the word of the Lord spread widely, and grew in power. N.T. Wright comments, Paul must have loved those days. He was busy in the shop, and he was busy teaching. People crowded in to hear his lectures. People brought sick people for healing and turned to look as he went by. Jesus was Lord, and he was his apostle. Well, while on this high, if you will, on this mountaintop, Paul decided to go and visit a church that was dear to his heart, a church that he spent at least 18 months planting and nurturing, the church at Corinth. Now, we don't know exactly what happened when Paul turned up at Corinth. We know that he expected to be welcomed with open arms, that it would have been a sort of homecoming for him, returning home to Corinth, to this people that he loved and that loved him. But what he received when he went home to Corinth was utter rejection. It is thought that he may have even been openly mocked by a leader at Corinth. Apollos, who was an elegant speaker, had become the new star for Corinth, and Paul was chopped liver. As a pastor, I couldn't imagine what it would feel like. It'd be like me returning to a church that I'd served for, you know, a couple years, and the doors to be barred to me. It'd be like you all as a congregation turning your back on me. The pain and the devastation that he in his heart of hearts would have felt, it would have been tremendous. The bitter pains of rejection. The letter of 2 Corinthians was written in response to whatever it was that happened. The tone between it and 1 Corinthians is night and day. I challenge you to read them both side by side. Just as other letters, just as our letters, just as our text, just as our emails can capture our mood when written, well, so 2 Corinthians captures Paul's mood from that visit. It's just heavy. At one point in it, he says, we are under all kinds of pressure, but we are not crushed completely. We are at a loss, but not at our wits' end. We are persecuted, but we're not abandoned. He says, we are cast down, but we're not destroyed. Earlier in the letter, he goes so far to say that he did feel destroyed, though, that he did feel crushed at one point. But as he says in chapter 4 here, he obviously wasn't. But hear the despair in these next couple verses. They capture his mood also well. They capture this almost breaking point also well. 2 Corinthians 1:8-9. It's probably one of the heaviest verses that I've ever found in the Bible. He says, the load that we had to carry. He says, and you just feel the trembling. He says, it was far too heavy for us. He says, it got to the point we gave up on life itself. He says, yes, deep inside ourselves. He says, we received the death sentence. Whew. You know, that'd be heavy. Paul, after whatever happened at Corinth, well, he changed his initial plans, tucked his tail, and ran home to where things had been going all so well. And then he went home to Ephesus. Only it was then that the riot broke out. Already in a defeated state, already struggling at his core, already feeling as if he had been poured out to the point of bone dry, and then his beloved Ephesus was in a riot. When he left, it was just teeming with people coming to know Christ. Ministry was flourishing, and he returns to a riot. Somewhere in the neighborhood of 50,000 people had gathered in an outdoor auditorium designed to make noise carry through the streets. People chanted for hours, at least two, "Great is Artemis of the Ephesians! Great is Artemis of the Ephesians!" They chanted this over and over and over and over. And imagine with every chant caused the pain within Paul's heart to multiply. And he writes comments. As a surge of excitement ebbs away, he is more drained than before. And he asks himself, has it all been for nothing? If that weren't enough, depressing enough, then he gets tossed in jail. I think Paul, the most prominent of the new writer of the New Testament, the apostle to the Gentiles, I think he knew how challenging life, ministry, work, family can be. He knew what it was like to be unsure if you could keep on keeping on. I mean, in his own words, he felt as if he had been internally given a death sentence. Those words were a summation of all that he experienced from Corinth to Ephesus, an eternal death sentence. And here's where the good news comes in. Yet it was from this despairing season, it was from this despairing chapter of his life, this valley, green as valleys are, that some of his best work was resurrected from. For it was when he didn't give up. It was when he dug in just a little bit more. When he held on just a little bit longer. When he set his roots just a little more into the depth of who God is and his word and this Messiah. That Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, and Philemon was written. Out of the depths of despair, a bright light was shown in Paul's heart. And out of that, some of the most powerful and inspiring letters of the New Testament came. This makes me think of a song that Sarah and I have been listening to over and over again. You'll see us every once in a while post different songs on YouTube. And this is one that has been stuck on repeat for, a couple months now, I'd say. But the song's entitled, "Shall Not Want." Check out just a bit of it.
Will you be my light when I cannot see? And when I can't take another step, Lord, would you carry me? And when I've lost my fight, will you be my strength? And will you set me a table in the presence of my enemies? I shall not want. I shall not want. Oh, my soul's got a shepherd in the valley, and I shall not want. I shall not want. I shall not want. Cause my cup's running over and I shall not want. And I will lift my eyes to where my help comes from. And I won't be afraid of the shadow cause I've seen the sun. No, I will not stop when the way gets hard. Cause the green only grows in the valley and that's where you are. Say it. I shall not walk. No, no, I shall not walk. Hey. No, my soul's got a shepherd in the valley and I shall not walk.
I love that song. But this verse says, I will lift my eyes to where my help comes from. It says, I won't be afraid of the shadow because I've seen the sun. And this next one. It says, no, I will not stop when the way gets hard because the green only grows in the valley. And that's where you are. You know, there's not much vegetation and not much lush greenery on those mountaintops, is there? But oh, look at that valley. Paul was in a valley, and it was arguably one of the worst and one of the most beneficial valleys he'd ever entered. And to right, he has something else to say. He says, I think that like a plant in harsh winter, Paul in prison was forced to put his roots down even deeper than he had yet gone into the biblical tradition, and deeper again still within that tradition into the meaning of Jesus and his death. The roots slowly found moisture from the depth of that dark soil, way below previous consciousness. He drew hope and new possibilities. The fruit of that labor remains to this day near the heart of Christian belief. In that valley, Paul found anew, or for the first time, that in Christ there is a well of power, a well of oomph, a well of life, that never in any circumstance, even during a pandemic, even when the diagnosis has come, even when the challenges of our health seem to be just mounting and mounting, that never runs dry. Yes, in of himself, he could have been left to despair. But with God, he found there is no situation that's truly devoid of hope. Rather, with God, he found that the most apparently despairing situations is where God can cause the most growth within our lives. Paul reflected in that valley, I'm sure, on how Jesus must have felt upon that cross. Life barely holding on, and then for Jesus, life temporarily faded. But then, even when death had taken Jesus, hope was not gone. For death could not hold Jesus, for he was and is life himself. And then, as a despairing as a season, a few days that was for his disciples, Jesus came back to life. Paul drew upon this core belief of the Christian faith and found that the resurrection of Christ pertained not just to when we die, but pertains to when life strikes while we are very much alive. He found that the same power that rose Jesus from the grave is the same power that we as Christians can live relying upon today. How can I make these claims? It's the story behind the story of verses 19 and 20. And his, Jesus's, incomparably great power for us who believe. That power is the same as the mighty strength he exerted when he raised Christ from the dead. Paul understood that Christ could bring that same resurrecting power to those deathly circumstances that we may find ourselves in. Those circumstances that seem to drain every ounce of life and hope that we have within. But if we would just draw from the water, draw from the well of Christ, the well that in John 4 says that never runs dry, then we will always have what is needed to keep on keeping on, no matter what life brings. And we can know that it is in the valley, that it is in those dark seasons, that it is in those troubling times, that God has a way of bringing about the most growth in our lives. It can turn the most despairing situation into one of the most hope-filled situations because you planted Christ and you planted a cross right in the center of it. You know, there's this idea that's just kind of bouncing around in my mind. You know, many of us have breath in our lungs but have lived as a dead man and a dead woman for far too long. Christ wants us to be alive, to be full of life and love, to be a people that live out our days as a cup that is running over. And the way for us to live this sort of abundant life, not a life of just getting by, but a life of abundance, is drawing again and again and again from the well that never runs dry. Yes, Paul experienced what it was like to be poured out like a drink offering. He experienced the harshness to the pinnacle of what life can deal, and we've only scratched the surface of what he endured for the gospel. But Paul, he also experienced the perpetual spring, the power that was able to even defeat death. He experienced that which the Lord can bring to all of our lives, that which is needed to not despair, to not give up, to not throw in the towel, but to keep on keeping on, no matter what. So in closing, the next time you don't know if you can throw another bale, I say run for my dad. I say reach for that same source of strength and listen to this word of encouragement and know that with him, you can.
Let's stand and sing, "I am thine, O Lord, I have heard thy voice." Blessed Lord.
Let's close out with a word of prayer together. Lord Jesus, may we be a people that keep our heads held high, not because of pride, but God, because of you. A people that have our eyes fixated upon the Son, fixated upon you, the one who defeated death, and the one that holds our hope and holds our future in your hands. And all God's people said, Mr. Jim Turney. Truly, the wonders of it all grow with God. Stay hopeful. Look out for each other. See you all next time. Take care.